just a brief recap of what we said last week. We read chapter 3 of the book of John, verse 16. Just want to get back there. Very common verse we all memorized at some point. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And like verse 17, the Bible says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." That's the verse we read. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." We said that man lost his glory, he lost his dominion, he lost his power. Man lost his place. And God's intention was to bring man back to his place. We also talked about if we are not going to, if you allow people to be the way they are, if we allow people to be the way they are, like they're not born again, and they live the way they are the rest of their life, they're going to live life that has no meaning. They're going to live life that has no fulfillment, because they never know why they exist, and they live anyhowly, and they live the way they want. Some even die before their time, drinking and doing any manner of things. So the end of these people will be hell. I explained to you what hell is like. Hell is not a place you enjoy being. Utafurahia kuwa jehanamu. Na hatima ya wale ambao wana kataa kumwamini Yesu sio tu jehanamu. Then from there they will be transferred to the lake of fire. So we are also showing them there is some danger, or big danger, terrible danger awaiting you if you are not receiving Jesus. The life that these people are going to live after death cannot be compared to the life they live when they are alive on earth. 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years. But after you live here, you go and live for eternity, where there is no time for the rest. The biggest number is it zillion? Something like zillion somewhere? Now we know of trillion. But is there something called zillion? After trillion. Now even zillion cannot describe the number of years somebody lives after they die. Because they are not going to die, in fact. How can I put it? They are going to live in lake of fire for the rest of their life. So this reality I'm saying must be brought to somebody's attention. This is not with the intention of threatening somebody to get saved. It is just to make them aware. Just to make them aware that number one, there is God who created you. Number two, there is a life he expects you to live. Number three, there's a purpose for which you need to bring to pass on earth. Therefore, if you're not ready for that life of this plan that God has for you, if you go against the plan of God, the next thing is hell. The other one is heaven. So you choose. Both heaven and hell will pass away. Even heaven will be brought down. I'm speaking about after heaven is brought down, what next? Chapter 21 of the book of Revelation. Last night and this night, we are talking about chapter 18 and 19 of the book of Revelation. Next week, we're going to talk about chapter 20 and 21 of the book of Revelation. And we show people how hell is thrown in lake of fire, and heaven is also brought down, and New Jerusalem is introduced. So looking at the future, somebody must plan his life today. And then I brought you to a place, we read chapter number 5 of 2 Corinthians from verse 17 to 21. Back to be precise, 20. Where we said God has called us to reconcile the world to Christ. And there the Bible says, just like we read in the book of John, let me just read it. I'm reading 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. Verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature, all things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Verse 18, and all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19 says, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Verse 20, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. I want to read in NLT version. What I've just read makes very clear. Verse 19. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sin against them. This is the wonderful message he has given us to tell us, to tell others, sorry. Then verse 20 says, we are Christ's ambassadors, and God is using us to speak to us, to you. We urge you, as though Christ himself were here pleading with you, be reconciled to God. Be reconciled to God. I think this is what we read last week. We talked about evangelism. We talked about why somebody should get saved. We talked about the reality of hell and lake of fire. Then we also finished by saying, we are the people who are to tell others about Jesus. Now, I want to pick from there and move on. I'm just flashing back just for some of us to catch up with what we're doing. A structure like this is not church, this is just a building. A structure like this has been put in place so that people are informed. There is God who created them. We studied in our morning devotion, chapter 25 of Exodus, when God first introduced a structure of this kind. He delivered his children from Egypt, and in the wilderness, he began a church. He began a church. The church he began He asked, he gave Luke chapter 25, you understand what I'm talking about. He told Moses, put up a sanctuary. Then he says, I want to live among my people. And he positioned them. Three tribes to the north, three tribes to the east, south, sorry. The other tribes to the east, and the other one to the west. That's when the idea of church began in Exodus 25. It says, I want to live among. So if they put a structure here, the Israelites are surrounding the structure, meaning God is inside. So they have opportunity to come in. And the main reason is God says, I want to be among them. Then he also says, I want to speak to them, to my people. So when you see a structured race like this one, this is a sign that there is God in heaven. And it's a sign that God is interested in the lives of people. But the New Testament is different when it comes to, when you talk about a church, as you compare to this other one. The Israelites, by virtue of their birth, and they came from Abraham, I'm saying by virtue of their birth, they came out of Abraham. They belong to that group. But God was up to something when he called Abraham. God was making a way through which he will reach the whole world. So through Abraham is to bring Jesus. And Jesus is now to bring back the whole world, all human beings who died in sin, is to bring them back to Christ, back to God. So when Jesus came through the children of Israelites, and he specifically came to die for human sin, that is not all. Because it is not just, Jesus didn't just come to die so that your sin is forgiven and then we forget about you. He came for bigger purpose. He came to reintroduce the kingdom of heaven on earth. There was no kingdom of heaven on earth before Jesus came. The devil toppled, he brought down the kingdom of God by making Adam a sinner. When Adam sinned, the devil took over and he was then running the whole world until Jesus came. And when Jesus came, he says, repent. For the kingdom of God is here. Who is introducing? Jesus himself. So that now everything is turned upside down. And God is introduced afresh on earth. And people are called back to God. New information are taught to them. New ways of life. There has to be a turnaround when somebody gets to know God. They are not going to live the way they used to live. Their priorities will never remain the same. So Jesus, when he died, now he made all humans on the earth to be candidate for this salvation, or for them to become the children of God. Meaning all humans are not children of God. Is only when you get born again, believe in Jesus, then you come back to him. He shows you his way. So our responsibility is to bring back them that have lost their direction in God, and they are everywhere living some very useless life that they are not happy about. People who are living, but they don't know why they are living. People who don't have answers to questions, to problems of life. People who don't have any It's like we are living anyhow. Somebody must have an explanation of what is happening, why they're existing, where they're heading, what happens after they die. Or somebody has to have and somebody has to be certain of our confidence of the kind of life they're living now, and even confidence in the life to come. One of the reasons that people cry when somebody dies, I think there might be some several reasons. The first reason is they feel like maybe somebody died early. Mekufa mapema. Angefaa kuenda. Somebody was mourning Magoha. I was watching yesterday. And that person says, we are sad he died in his prime age. The guy is 70 years. Are you aware of that? 70 years. They're saying now when he's to begin living. I like that. That was Ida who said that. Ida Raila. She said she died in his prime age. Sasa ngefaa kuishi. Baba ni mwaka ngapi? How old is he? By now? Huh? 80 something. So Ida is? Maybe she's around 70, we don't know. So she's feeling like they're now beginning to live. I like their percentage. Some of us are praying to figure out a 50. I'm a 60. I'm getting now na ko 70, so send your maisha inaanza. Wengine wanasema maisha inaanza at 40. Hawa wanasema maisha inaanza at 70. Wakati yuko na mjuku, a grandson, a girl. So, that's one of the reasons why people mourn. In fact, majorly the reasons why people mourn when someone dies is simply because they will not see him again. But the reason why we need to cry, I don't know if that cry will help in any way. The reason why we need to cry for the dead is if they have not received Christ. If somebody has received Christ, there's no pain. In fact, the remaining life they live, zillions of years, is joy. That's why many men of God don't really treat this life as something that you, how can I put it? They can sacrifice their lives. They can do anything as long as making the work of God happening. As long as making the work of God happen is possible. They do anything. They can go without anything that you think is very good. Because what you're not aware is, there's a life after this that people live for eternity. No dying there. Hakuna burial. Huko. Atani kufa kuja tumbali. Hakuna. Utaishi milele. Either kwa moto ama kwa. In heaven or in. Not heaven. Heaven has already been removed. After that. So, that's after 1,000 years of Jesus' reigns. Heaven and earth will be removed and a new system will be introduced. So that those are the years we are talking about. Not these 50 years, not these 60 years. So when you have the perspective of eternity, ukiwa na mtazamo wa umilele, when you are looking at sasa hii miaka 50, 60, hii 70, that's why miaka sabini, ama sitini, ama mia, kama utafaulu kufika hapo. Hii ni ya kujipanga kuishi huko nyuma. This is the life we prepare to live for. The one that is coming, which has no end. So if we are to do evangelism, people have to be given this perspective. Kuna wale wanasema, kuna mbingu. The there are atheists who have just came up and they say there's no God. Hell is just a fiction. Heaven is also. And for them, but they find it rough. Sema wakati nimekufa maisha imeishia. Na watuambia walizaliwa aje. Na kwa nini? How they came on earth, beginning from first Adam. They cannot tell us. But they still believe hakuna Mungu. Ninyi mnapiga tu nduru. Ninyi mna poteza wakati. So there are all manner of people on earth who don't have God's perspective or right perspective. So our responsibility is to bring them. Whether you are old or you are young, this command has been given to us. Let's read chapter number. I'm still on the basics. Let's read Matthew chapter number 28. Matthew 28. Beginning from verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. He says, now after he gave them authority, verse 18, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore. All power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go ye therefore. All power. After he went to hell, that is where he went to meet with the devil himself. The man who has the dominion. The man who has the dominion. He took from Adam. And then he came back. And now he tells us, go. Make disciples. Go and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Go. It says, go to all nations of the earth and bring them back to God. So that word go is the reason we are here. That word go is the reason as to why we are here. And we are to look around and see who has not heard this gospel. Who has not believed in this truth. And we are bringing them to the knowledge of the truth. In chapter number 1 of the book of, let's read Acts chapter 1. Reading to you scriptures about God. It says in verse 8, Acts 1:8, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. He's also talking about God. The Holy Spirit comes on you, you shall receive power. Matthew 28:18, the Bible says, all power has been given to me. And then it says, go. Here he says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, go. Begin from Jerusalem. all Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. So, and then it says, you will be my witnesses. The word there is witness. You will be my witness to all people around the world. Now this is being spoken to all believers, whether you are children, I don't know if Sunday school teachers are teaching these kids, whether you are youths, whether you are married, all of us, what somebody has to know you with is as a witness. That responsibility is given to everybody. Mahali watu nasema kubiri kupeana injini ama kuenda kutafuta waliopotea, nasema ni kazi ya pastor ama evangelist. In fact, kazi ya soul winning wamemwachia nani? Evangelist. So tunatafuta mtu anaitwa evangelist, tunaleka kwa kanisa. Kazi yake ni kuenda ku, na sisi tushampatia kazi evangelist. Sisi yatufanya ni yatutafuti. Ini kazi ni ya kila mtu. Every believer, one of your life mission, I'm saying one of your life mission, jukumu lako moja kama muamini ama aliye muamini Kristo ni kwa hamasisha. Can I use that word? Yeyote mwenye hajawahi muamini Kristo, kumwambia kuna sababu wewe ungefaa kuokoka. There's a reason as to why you have to get saved. Kila muamini, everybody, kama umemwamini Yesu na unafahamu umuhimu wa Yesu, kama amekuwa msaada katika maisha yako, amekupa mwelekeo kwa maisha, hiyo ni jukumu la kila mtu ambaye ameamini Kristo. Haijalishi uko wapi, everywhere, whether uko Marsabit, Siolo, Nairobi, ama tukijikuta abroad, US, UK. This preaching happens everywhere on earth. Na kama kuna sababu tuko hapa duniani, ni hii tu. Na baada ya wakati wa kuhubiri ukiisha, when the preaching of the gospel comes to an end, hiyo ikiisha, kila mtu atakuwa mahali. Mwingine ako na Mungu mahali fulani, mwingine ako na shetani. Na wakati wetu wa kuhubiri ni kama inaisha. In fact, it's coming to an end. Kwa hivyo kila mtu, everybody becomes a witness. My emphasis today is about witness. And who is a witness? Is a witness. God Jesus is saying that you will be my witnesses beginning from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the earth. In other words, everywhere human beings are, kila mahali wanadamu wako, nyinyi ndio mngefaa kwenda. All color of people, all tribes, all Yesu amekufa kwa sababu ya wote. That lady is called who was here the other day. Winnie na mwenye alikuwa na sisi hapa na Sunday matone, I think. Alisema ako ilret. Na mtu ako na miaka 65. Hajawahi sikia Yesu. Namwambia kuna mtu anaitwa Yesu, eh? Burden ya kuwafikia hawa ndio ilipeleka yeye ilret. He's a lady of less than 30 years. Burden tu ya kuhubiri ikamfikisha pale. A witness. Witness kwa Kiswahili ni shahidi. Shahidi ni nani? Who is a witness? Somebody who has first hand information. First hand information about any kind of happening or about a person. First hand information. First hand information. Umekutana na Yesu, amekuwa wa msaada kwako kwa sababu ulimwamini na ukaamua kukaa katika hiyo kovu. Sasa unaambiwa kama ulipata faida kwa kuhusika ama kwa kuhusishwa ama kwa kupata by relating to Christ, umehusiana na Yesu, umeongea na yeye, amenena na wewe, umekusaidia katika maisha yenye maisha, umeona uzuri wake. Sasa wewe inabidi uambie we wengine kuhusu huyu Yesu. Witness. Everybody should be witness. When the church does not have the sense of reaching out to the lost, Bernard Bonke anasema hiyo kanisa yenyewe ishapotea. Kama kanisa, if a church does not have any sense of reaching out to the lost, kama hawafikiri kufikia wale ambao wamepotea, wao pia wamepotea. If a church, what makes church to be alive and alert and meaningful is when the lost are coming into the church, receiving salvation, their life being transformed. Nasema kanisa itakuwa na maana wakati wanawaza kuhusu wale ambao wamepotea na wahusiani na Mungu. Tunaenda kuwatafuta na tunawaleta kwa kanisa, tunawafundisha, tabia ya watu zinabadilika. Hapo ndio Mungu anapata utukufu. Lakini kama hakuna kutoka nje, tafuta wale ambao wamepotea, unaishi na yule amepotea kana kwamba tu kama tu wewe mwenyewe tu umepotea. Unataka kujua miaka ambayo tulipewa baada ya Yesu kukufa na kufufuka na kupaa kule mbinguni, hii miaka 2000 tulipewa tu kutafuta waliopotea. All these years, what God knows is people will come back to Him. All these, hakuna kazi ingine Mungu ameacha kwa dunia. Hata kama wewe ni mwalimu, mwingine ni wana biashara, mwingine ni whichever work you're doing. Kazi yenye tungefaa kufanya popote penye tunaenda, ofisini, sokoni, shuleni, everywhere. If you come around somebody who's not born again, unawashuhudia. Hata kama wataamini, ukiwashuhudia ama ukiwaambia kuhusu Yesu, kazi yako ni kufanya nini? Kumwambia ukweli wa neno. This is the truth of the matter. This is the truth of the matter. This is what God expects of you. This. Why be your, I think that is the work we have. You bring in people, they are established in the truth. Ukileta watu wafike kiwango ambacho wamekoma, unaenda kuongeza wengine, kisimama, naongeza wengine. Hiyo ndio kazi yetu tunafanya. As we are living, the more new people come to our system, learn the word of God, their life transformed, changed, and they feel fulfilled. The more fulfilled we be. There is a crown that is given to people who bring others to Christ. I'm saying there's a crown for them that bring the lost to Christ. So, even as we stay in here, hata tunapokaa hapa ndani, inabidi tuwe na hiyo hisia ya kujukumika, the sense of responsibility ya kufikia wengine waje kwa Kristo na maisha yao yabadilike. There has to be that sense. There has to be that sense. The sense of responsibility where you feel and even pray about it. That's why now prayer has to be done. Somebody, kila kitu tunafanya inaanza katika maombi. God, bring these people my way. Let them come. Wherever they are. Praying even for them that are around you. You know what you are. God, bring these people to faith. Create a desire that of having a hunger to come to you, to live for you. Just to begin in prayer. I'm saying everybody should pray. Let God bring. Jesus says in chapter 10 of the book of John, says there are some of my sheep that are not here. They are somewhere. Anasema kuna kondoo wangu wenye wasaizi ya wako hapa. Lakini watakuja. Kuna wengi wako nje lakini wata na nani anawaleta? Nauliza tu swali, nani anawaleta hawa wenye wako nje huko, wenye fait quoi? Na wako tu mahali ambapo wewe uko. Kama ni neighbor wako nyumbani. Penye unakaa, kama ni unafanya kazi na yeye. Kama ni jamii yako, whoever it is. Kila mmoja wetu tuna jukumu la kuleta wale ambao hawajawahi ishi wakijua kuna kusudi Mungu ameleta wao duniani. There's a purpose for which God has brought them on earth. There's a purpose. Kama kuna wenye hawajajua, hiyo ni kazi yetu sasa. Is our work. That's why I think evangelism is done. That's why crusades are done and some of these things. Nataka kunena sana leo. I think hiyo inatosha. In that line. That is enough for today. So kwa hivyo next week I'm still speaking on this. I'll be very specific. But today my topic is you are a witness of Christ. Wewe ndio unafahamu kuhusu Yesu ndio sababu umekuja kanisani. Nabi kama ujaokoka tukusaidia uokoke. Then tukutume pia kwenda kutafuta. Kama ni rafiki yako, kama ni jamii yako, kama ni yote tu mwenye umefanya kazi na whoever the person is. So yeah, I think that is all for now. Lord, we are thankful for speaking to us this word about evangelism, where we become a witness, your witness in our land. We pray that you give us the capacity and ability to do this ministry of reconciliation.